John's been reminding us through this book that these events that he's describing are not some future, I wonder when, terrifying, fearful moment in the history of the church. These events are descriptions of how the Holy Spirit works in us to be faithful to Jesus day to day, even when it's difficult to do. And we're coming to the point at the end of this book where we get two glimpses. One is of what's waiting for us one day. The other is the foretaste that we get right now of what's waiting for us one day. When I was about 6 years old, my Uncle Ed, a red-headed Irishman, a miner, whose kids were terrified of him, but he had a soft spot for me. He took me fishing at Monongahela River. We caught 2 8-inch catfish. Okay. They looked huge when I was 6. I think they were probably about 8 inches. And I wanted to keep them. Ed was thinking to himself, this could have been a meal, but okay, let's take the catfish home. Found a bucket, put some river water in it, took the catfish home. He found a galvanized tub, half filled it, and put the catfish in there, and I was happy. Checked on the next day, and the water was getting kind of cloudy. I didn't understand it, but I thought, okay, they're still there, they're still going great. I was happy. Within a couple of days, not only was the water getting cloudier, but I went down and one of the fish was floating upside down. And I went to my aunt and I said, what's going on? And she broke the bad news to me. It was the first time I experienced the death of a pet. And it was heartbreaking. Then the next day, the other fish did the very same thing. What I didn't understand in my youthful enthusiasm for these amazing creatures is that they were not intended to live in an environment that was intended to give them life but wound up becoming toxic for them. Something like that happened with Adam and Eve in the garden. If you have a Bible, you turn with me to Genesis chapter 3. They've both eaten of the apple, or whatever the fruit was, the Bible doesn't specifically say. God has pronounced the curse on all creation and on them. And then he says, Genesis 3 and verse 22, and the Lord God said, the man, meaning both Adam and Eve, has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever. What at one time had been the promise of abundant life, eating from that tree of life, now, because of their disobedience and the fact that their relationship with the Lord has been cut off, if they would eat from that tree, they would live forever as sinful dead people. Cut off from God forever. Do you know another definition for being cut off from God forever? That's a picture of hell. The Lord loved them too much to let them get in that state. And so rather than take the risk that they would eat from the tree of life and live forever in this awful state, he banished them from the garden. Yes, it was punishment for their disobedience, but it was also to prevent them from getting in a state that would last forever horribly. With the promise that one day he would turn this all around, he would make it possible for them and all their descendants to return to the home they belonged in. The rest of the Bible is the account the centerpiece of that account is the sending of his son to die and rise again and make possible everyone who will to come and experience eternal life. And then back in Revelation 21, when time is done, God says, it is done. This whole great, grand experience of history is over, and something new is about to happen. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the one who makes all this happen. And then this promise is given not only to those who don't yet know Jesus. This promise is given to God's people. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of the water of life. It means that God longs for a relationship with each one of us. Yes, he knows us. He knows us personally. He knows us intimately. But knowing someone is not the same as having that relationship with them. And God longs for that relationship with each one of us. It's a choice that we make personally, individually. I am so thrilled for what Gracie is becoming as a gymnast. The fact is, Chris and Kathy's faith will not bring Gracie to the throne of grace. Gracie, when the time comes, needs to make that choice, as each of us does. And when that choice comes, then we discover what it means to have the Holy Spirit living in us and flowing through us. The river of life flowing through us, the presence of the Holy Spirit. I've never been stranded on a raft in the middle of the ocean. I've heard accounts of people who have. And in a very old poem called The Rime of the Ancient Mariner, there is this line, water, water everywhere. You know how it ends. And not a drop to drink. Look at all that water. And when you're on a raft and the sun is beating down and everything about you is just parched, and all that water is sitting there saying, drink me. And the worst possible thing to do is to take that first sip, just to cool yourself a little bit, just to quench that thirst a little bit, because all the salt in that ocean water will dry everything out much faster and make you thirstier. So that you take the next sip, thinking maybe that'll help. And that compounds the thirst, and the longer you go, the more the salts build up inside of your kidneys pretty soon. So what are you doing to me? And it will kill you. That's the experience of life without Jesus, looking for something to satisfy, something that will fulfill me, something that will make me feel as if I'm worthwhile. So the river that flows from the throne of God, the presence of the Holy Spirit, the one and only thing guaranteed to satisfy that inner desire. In 2006, some of you remember the name David Copperfield, not the Charles Dickens character, but the illusionist. The guy who made the Statue of Liberty vanish. He bought 4 tiny islands in the southern Bahamas. Paid $50 million for those 4 islands, but he thinks he got a bargain. He believes that one of those islands discovered a true phenomenon. You can take dead leaves, they come in contact with the water and they become full of life again. Bugs or insects that are near death come in contact with the water and they fly away. It is an amazing thing. It's really exciting. Okay, even if there is source of water on that island that can restore life to leaves and bugs, it will not satisfy the real aching need in every human being. Not for the fountain of youth, but for the presence of the Holy Spirit. To personally drink from that spring is what life is about. And not only taking a sip, but keeping in regular contact. In Revelation 22:1 is this verse. And the angel showed me the river of the water of life as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God. We just sang these words. Drinking from the springs of living water. It doesn't say I did drink from them at one point, does it? I remember as a kid, I keep coming up with these memories. My grandfather would take me to Chetlick's Meat Market. It was about 4 miles from our house. And where we lived, everything was hills. Everywhere was hills. And just about a quarter mile on this side of Chetlick's Meat Market, someone had driven a pipe into the side of the hill. The coldest, clearest water you can possibly imagine flowed out of that all the time. Anytime Grandpa and I would go to the market, we would stop with some jugs and fill them up with that water and we would take it back. And forget the tap water. This is stuff from the spring. That's the experience of not only taking a sip, but continually drinking from that spring. It's not enough to get that one sip and think that'll last you for a lifetime. You need to keep drinking. One man who had been reared in the city bought a farm and several milk cows. In the feed store one day, he complained that his best cow had gone dry. Aren't you feeding her right? The store owner asked. Yeah, I'm feeding her exactly what you gave me to feed them. Are you milking them every day? Just about. If I get up in the morning and I need some milk for my cereal, I go out and I'll get 6 ounces or so and take it back in. And if I don't need it, I just leave it there and let her store it for me. And all the farmers are saying, are you out of your mind? What's a guy like that doing trying to raise cows? So the feed store owner had to explain to him, you gotta milk them every day. Whether you need the milk or not, you gotta milk them every day. And that's very much the case for us who know Jesus. We need that source of life-giving water, the presence of the Holy Spirit every day. It doesn't mean that every day you've got to spend a half hour in prayer. It does mean that every day you block out some time just to be quiet with Him. That's hard. But the question is, how much of your life do you want to have permeated by His presence? There are things that do block the presence of the Holy Spirit and His flow in our lives. Things like unconfessed sin. Things like unresolved issues with other people, especially unforgiveness. And there is this third thing. A lack of outlet for the Spirit's flow. What does that mean? If you were to go to Jesus' hometown of Nazareth and see of Israel have Nazareth at the north and the Dead Sea at the south, and it looks like that. Flip it around. Imagine that you're standing at Nazareth and looking south. There is normally we see the Mediterranean Sea on the left. In this picture, it's on the right because we're looking south. And that lower blue triangle is the Sea of Galilee. That beautiful, gentle, occasionally stormy, fish-filled lake where so many of Jesus' miracles and Peter's livelihood came from. If you follow up and you see that darker patch, that's the Dead Sea. Nothing lives in the Dead Sea. And the reason for that is because the Dead Sea is almost 9 times saltier than the ocean is. It's hard to drown in the Dead Sea. It's difficult even to swim because the buoyancy from that salt is so strong, it's hard to get enough of your body under to actually swim. The reasons this sea is dead is because it has no natural outlet. All the water that comes in from the Jordan River and flowing to the Dead Sea run off from the hills, makes its way down, and the runoff has traces of salt, just minuscule amounts. But when it gets to the Dead Sea, it has no place to go, so it sits there until it evaporates and it leaves behind those traces of salt. So over the years, the salt has built up. Anything that might have lived there died, and there's no way for any of the water to get out south of the Dead Sea. No outlets. When the Holy Spirit flows through you, you need those outlets to be able to touch someone else with Jesus' love, or to forgive someone else, or to serve in some way. An outlet for the Holy Spirit to be able to work through you. If you don't have any outlets, if you're trying to do the me and Jesus thing and just keep it to yourself, it goes sour. What happens on those days when you don't have any unconfessed sin that you're aware of, and you don't have any issues with someone else, and you've got plenty of outlets for the Holy Spirit to work through you? In fact, probably too many. And still, just isn't well for soul. There are those days when Father knows that you need that time because you get less and less dependent on things working out well around you, and you become more and more dependent on His presence with you. On those days when no matter how much you try to smile on a Sunday morning, your heart is still broken. And then you get with God and you say, I am so thirsty and I hurt so much and I don't understand why I feel this way. And at that point, you may not hear a thing. It's not because God has abandoned you. It's because He is teaching you trust Him, even when you don't feel the flow. Because the promise is, if you trust Him through that dark time, the flow will come again. This time, in a richer, deeper way. Because you've gone deeper. Not so dependent on how it feels and how things are working out. We're trusting Him. What Adam and Eve discovered in the garden, that life-giving river that flowed from Eden out to the other four major rivers, that life-giving fruit, we get as a foretaste now to help us hang in there for what's waiting for us. Some of you are facing that very difficult time right now. Some of you you may be walking in